Hey guys.
So in this session, we'll be discussing about your cleft lip and palate. So basically, any clefting, a cleft means it results as to incomplete fusion. Okay, it is a result of incomplete fusion, and there is a cleft or a gap formation where the tissues are incompletely fused together. So cleft, normally you can either see clefting of your lip or clefting of your palate, or both your lip and palate, cleft lip and palate combined. Okay. So cleft of the lip, the alveolus, hard and soft palate are the most common congenital anomalies of the oral facial structures. So the term here is your congenital anomalies. Okay, they are congenital, they are by birth itself. They frequently occur as isolated deformities, but can be associated with other medical conditions or other medical syndromes like your congenital heart diseases. So we learned they are developmental or congenital. They are the most common abnormalities of the oral facial structures. They can occur isolated or with superimposed with other conditions like your congenital heart diseases. Now, how are your cleft lip and palate formed? As you all know, during development of the face, you might have studied, there are various processes like your, there is something called as your median nasal process. Okay, there is something called as your lateral nasal process. Okay, and below that you get something called as your maxillary process. Okay, and selective fusion of all these in a pre-orchestrized fine planned manner results in the formation of a perfect face. So the cleft lip, it is formed due to disturbance during the 6th week of intrauterine life. Very important. These are frequently asked previous questions. Okay. Cleft lip is formed due to different disturbance in your 6th week of intrauterine life. That is between the 4th or the 8th week. The cleft palate is formed a little later due to disturbance occurring during the 8th week of intrauterine life. That is between the 8th to 12th week. The cleft lip, as I told you, is formed due to the defect in fusion of the median nasal process with the maxillary process. These two, the median nasal process with the maxillary process. The lateral nasal process, what I have drawn in orange, the lateral nasal process, it does not take part in any formation of the upper lip. Okay, and clefting is mainly seen in your upper lip. The cleft palate is formed due to defective fusion of premaxilla developed from the median nasal process and the two palatine processes. Okay, it is due to development somewhere around here. Okay, the cleft palate, the central variety of cleft lip called as the hair lip, it is very rare. So they are basically seen in the sides, not in the center of the lip. The hair lip arises due to failure of fusion of two bulbous extremities of the median nasal processes, between the two median nasal processes, but it is very rare and it is called as your hair lip, H-A-R-E, hair lip. The upper cleft lip may be occasionally associated with the presence of two small blind tubes in the lower lip lined by squamous epithelium. These are called as inferior labial sinuses or mandibular recesses. I told you clefting, it mainly occurs in the upper lip. It may be accompanied with some deformity in your lower lip, but it does not cause clefting of your lower lip as such. But there is basically two pitting, and they are very small. They are not through and through. Very small canal like things in your lower lip called as small blind tubes, and these are lined by your squamous epithelium. The name is important. They are called as inferior labial sinuses or your mandibular recesses. Now, incidence and distribution. The incidence of cleft lip and palate, it is very common. That is around 1 in 600 live births, and isolation cleft palate alone, it is 1 in 1000. So the common cleft lip and palate, the combined variety is more common. The distribution is like cleft lip alone is forms 50% of all cases, isolated cleft palate forms 40%, and the combined, the cleft lip and palate forms around 45% of all the cases. So isolated cleft lip alone is rare among these three. The cleft lip and palate are more common in males, whereas cleft palate alone is more common in females. Okay. The negroid race has the lowest incidence, previous question. And the mongoloids have the highest incidence. Negroids are the lowest and the mongoloids have the highest incidence. You know, questions have come from this sentence itself. Okay. The cleft lip is common among males. Cleft palate among the females. Unilateral cleft counts for 80% of the incidence, and bilateral clefting accounts for 20% of the incidence. Among the unilateral clefting involving the left side are seen more commonly, that is in around 70% of all cases. The left side is more common than your right side. Etiology of cleft lip and palate can be both genetic and environmental. Okay, both genetic and environmental. There is something called as multifactorial etiology. Multifactorial means if the genetic variation of a particular phenotypic trait is dependent on the simultaneous segregation of many genes and affected by the environment itself. If the genetic variation is dependent upon the segregation of genes as well as affected by the environment, it is referred to as being subjected to multifactorial. Okay, it is your genetic plus environmental, that is called as a multifactorial. And that multifactorial model is best explain the etiology of your cleft lip with and without cleft palate. Whereas for your cleft palate alone, it is your environmental factors, okay, that exert more influence for the etiology. Now, there are two theories for cleft lip and palate. The first theory, as we mentioned before, it is a failure of fusion, theory of failure of fusion. It was given by Darcy Hirst in 1931. This theory, even though no longer in popularity, is very frequently used. As we learned, it is due to the failure of fusion of various processes during your development. This is no longer used, no longer accepted. Now the theory of accepted is your failure of mesodermal migration. You know, it was given by Fleischmann in 1910. The failure of mesodermal migration means, let's say, two processes are coming close together. This is lined by your epidermis or your epithelial layer, and inside you have your mesenchymal cells. Okay, for any process to form, this epithelium should disintegrate, and your mesenchymal cells or your mesodermal cells, they should come in contact and they should proliferate for the fusion to occur. This is how any tissue forms. So let's say the epithelium does not disintegrate. There is some disturbance in the disintegration of your epithelium. The mesenchymal cells do not come into contact, and that causes a clefting. So according to this theory, the cleft palate is due to the arrest of disappearance of the epithelial membrane, which remains intact. It doesn't disintegrate and is not penetrated by the adjacent mesoderm. The failure of sufficient mesoderm to migrate into a specific area, as we mentioned, is responsible for the persistence of the groove. This groove is not filled by your mesenchymal tissue. That gives rise to an established cleft. And even this theory is not universally accepted. You know, controversies are there. So the most frequently asked question, first one, which race, is most commonly affected? It is your mongoloid race. And which race is least affected? It is your negroid. Your left side is more commonly affected than your right side in unilateral clefting. Your cleft lip plus cleft palate is more common than your cleft palate, which is more common than your cleft lip. This is the order of frequency. Okay. And lastly, you have to know which week. For your cleft lip, it is the 6th week disturbance, and your cleft palate, it is the 8th week of disturbance.